Hi, Anjali. Not sure where the issue is. Okay, she's logging in again. Okay, I'll just hold up. Just bear with us, please. Couple more minutes. I think Bina is trying to come online. I've just accepted Bina's request to come online.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, great. Okay,
What
I
a
think
what
it's
a relief.
just a little bit of, technical issues that we seem to have once in a while. But great. Thank you so much for joining. So very quickly, welcome to all those who have come online. This is yet again a well-being chat, and today's topic of discussion is happiness matters. And I'm going to be in conversation with Bina Mirchandani, who's the chief faculty at Tambara Wellness. Bina also serves on the board of Ancient Wisdom, and plus she has over 40 years of expertise in brand and retail strategy, combined with 25 years of studying spiritual teachings. A big, big, big welcome to you, Bina. It's such a pleasure to have you on board and to be a part of our well-being weekend. So I'm really excited about this evening's chat. Yeah, would you like to say
Thank
hi
you.
to our viewers?
Yeah, thank you so much, Kavita, and I'm very, very happy to be here, as always.
Thank
I'm
you.
happiness mentor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I'm really excited about today's topic. So without wasting much time, let's get started.
Sure.
Now, I know, I have listened to, I think, a podcast of yours where you very, very beautifully define happiness, and probably we should start off asking you to define that. So, yeah, how would you define happiness?
Okay, so happiness means so much. It means different things to different people because we're all different. All right?
Right.
And what makes you happy doesn't necessarily make the other person happy. Okay? But
Absolutely.
I'm going to talk about the happiness from the Oxford English Dictionary. So happy is the feeling or showing pleasure of contentment or
Right.
contentment. And happiness is the state of being happy. But there's another happiness which is very long lasting, and that's called bliss, and that's
Okay.
perfect happiness. All
Okay.
right. So there are three things that define happiness, but an actual definition of happiness, I'd like to share a few with you. So Aristotle in the 3rd century BC talked about happiness is the meaning and the purpose of life, the whole aim and end of human existence. Which I think is absolutely right because, if you think of it, why do you do anything? Okay?
Right.
Why do you buy anything? Why do you have relationships with people? Why do you do anything at all? Why do you try and become rich? Why do you do anything? It's
Yeah.
all at the end of it, we're all trying to be happy. But we're going to talk a little
Yeah.
bit more about that. Yeah.
Right. I mean, that's so beautifully put, right? I mean, when you just look back and think, I mean, what is the purpose as we as humans do anything for a matter of fact?
Yeah.
Anything, every little thing that we do in life is because it's probably we're searching for happiness. Go on,
Yeah.
Bina.
So let me tell you a little bit more. So, and you know, there are a couple other Western psychologists who have defined happiness very nicely, and I'd like to share those definitions also with you. So Sonia Lobromisky, she's the professor of psychology at University of California, Riverside. And she says, the experience of joy, contentment, or positive well-being, combined with the sense that one's life is good, meaningful, and worthwhile. All right. I think that's also a very equally, a very nice definition. But I'd really like to ask you this one thing. Okay. So Tal Ben-Shehir was a professor at Harvard, and in the summer of 2006, he had a positive psychology class, which was, which has set a record for the highest number of people attending that class. So people were looking for happiness, even at Harvard, even though they had reached Harvard and they were accepted into Harvard, they were still looking for happiness. All right.
Right.
So Tal Ben-Shehir says, happiness is not about making it to the peak of the mountain, nor is it about the about climbing aimlessly around the mountain. So what do you think it is? What do you think it is all about? What do you think happiness is?
Well, if you ask me, I would personally say it's a journey.
Absolutely right. So he says, happiness is the experience of climbing towards the peak. You're bang on, Kavita. Yeah, absolutely true. Because what happens to us, and this is a question I ask many people, is that what do you think comes first, happiness or success?
Right. Well, I would say, I think there's a fulfillment of, for one to be successful, you have to be happy. Right. So, and I think they're very interrelated.
All right. So, in relation to what Tal Ben-Shehir said, and I'm going to tell you something, is that, you know, if you have a goal, you're trying to achieve a goal, and you always sometimes say that, you know, I'm waiting to reach that and then I'll be happy.
Right.
So what you've done is you've actually forgotten about the journey. But the stress of actually trying to reach that goal is actually making you unhappy along the way. That's the first thing. The other thing is that through actual research, they've proved that happy people are much more creative, have much more, you know, they're energetic. They have everything that it takes to actually reach a goal. And so happy people actually reach the goal much faster. All right. Their intelligence also rises, by the way.
Right. So would you say that it's about, you know, people being optimistic along the way?
It is being optimistic, but you know, there's a very, I'll tell you something very, very beautiful from Eastern, our Eastern philosophy. And it comes from the Bhagavad Gita, which says that when you're doing something, all right, don't look for the fruits of that. Because what you're doing, you're, what you're doing in effect is that you're wasting so much energy and stressing about the fact that you want to reach that particular goal.
Right.
So you're not able to put in the effort that you need to put in, you know, trying to reach there. So you're not able to put that full concentration in.
And you, you know, probably just miss out on all the finer details during the journey of reaching your goal, which is probably giving you a lot more happiness than you when you eventually reach your goal.
Yeah, absolutely true. And when you've actually reached that goal, you'll find that it makes you happy for a while. But then after that, you're on to another goal. You know, now you set yourself another goal. So then again, do you want to go through that whole journey with unhappiness and stress and worrying about whether you're going to reach that goal? Or do you want to make every single moment count? And do you want to make sure that you're happy every single moment of the journey? You know? And put, and when you are happy in that moment, you're putting every single effort into it. You know, the whole journey becomes pleasurable. You are more intelligent, like I told you. So there's a lot more of yourself getting into what you're doing. So you're enjoying what you're doing, and you're doing it slowly and reaching there. you know.
Right.
So it's very, very beautiful that one should actually do, you know, pay attention to this. That is one of the lessons, is living in the present moment.
Yeah.
So living in the present moment is very important, and not looking for the fruit of that. So it doesn't mean, by the way, it doesn't mean that don't have a goal.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that. It means set the goal. And then you have to certainly do certain things to reach that goal. But while you're doing them, be happy every step of the way.
Right. No, I think that's very beautifully beautifully put, Beena. Yeah. Now, you know, going on, you know, my second question to you would be, why do we want happiness?
Okay. All right. So why do we want happiness? I've got a few questions myself on Pilates.
Absolutely. Happy to answer them. Happy to take them on. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. So we'll finish why happiness. And then after that, I'm going to ask you a few questions as well.
Sure.
Okay. Sure. So why happiness? So Western psychology says that to be happy is the pursuit of any normal human being. Okay.
Right.
So compared to sadness, like I told you, happiness breeds an atmosphere of joy and strength that sustains and energizes us.
Okay.
Right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And to be happy at work, to be happy at play, to be happy in our homes and amidst our family is something that all of us desire.
Right.
So that's important. So it very clearly says that we're all looking for happiness. All right. Now, you know, while I was studying happiness, which I started doing several years back, I also was studying a lot of spiritual books and scriptures from Eastern philosophy. All right. And so we did a lot of study on many books like Bhagavad Gita, Tattva Bodha, Viveka Chudamani. And there was something very interesting in Eastern philosophy, which I'd like to share with you. Mm-hmm. Okay. So like it said that we all have different goals. Some of us want to be rich. Some of us want to be famous, powerful, loved and respected, but it all comes down to wanting to be happy, right?
Correct. Yeah.
So what do we do? Where do we search for this happiness? We're searching for this happiness in places, okay? We think that if we go to this location, I'm going to be happy. I'm not happy at home. Let me go for a holiday. But when you go for a holiday, then you're saying, okay, you know, it was good at home as well. You know, I should come back now. And you miss your home. So you're always looking, you're searching for happiness, right?
Right.
You look, you also always tend to say that, oh, these are not good times, you know, good times will come. So even time plays a part in your search for happiness.
Right.
We look at objects, you know, we think that we buy this and we're going to be happy. We buy that, or we get a bigger home, we buy that new car, we get that new watch, or, you know, we go out for that particular dinner or whatever we do. All sensual stimuli, and then we think this is going to make us happy.
Right.
Right? All right. We look for circumstances. We say, okay, let me get married and I'm going to be happy. All right. Mm-hmm. Which I think a lot of people will counter.
Yeah. Probably not this generation, because this generation, I mean, does not give a lot of importance to marriage per se. You know, they're like, okay, it's different, you know.
Totally. So then you say, okay, or you say for your job, oh, you know, I need to get that promotion. Otherwise, I'll be happy when I get that promotion. Meanwhile, I'm stewing in unhappiness, right? Waiting for that promotion. All right.
Yeah.
Also, people, we make relations, we break relations with people thinking that, and this happens a lot with this generation, I have to say, is that they think that, you know, okay, I'm not happy with this girl or this boy, you know, that one's better for me. And then they're flipping, you know, thinking that this one's going to make them happy or that situation's going to make them happy. There's a lot of this going on, right?
Correct.
Okay?
Yeah.
So where exactly is this happiness located? Now we said clearly that there is me, I'm experiencing all this. And then outside of me are all these objects, emotions and thoughts. All right.
Right. Yeah.
You would say emotions and thoughts, but these are other people's emotions and thoughts. And some may be in you, but they're actually a field.
Yeah.
So thoughts are a field. All right. So let's understand if happiness is in the nature of objects. Let's understand that. Okay.
Okay.
So let's take a piece of chocolate. All right.
Yeah.
you eat the first piece of chocolate and you're very, very happy.
Right. All right?
You eat the second piece and then now something's kicking in and you're starting to feel maybe a little guilty, or it's not giving you the same pleasure as the first one did.
Right.
You've had the third, you've had the fourth piece of chocolate, and then you're seriously thinking that this is not giving me much happiness.
Right.
Right? You know, and by the time you've had your 10th and 12th piece, you're actually sick of it.
Yeah.
Right? But if I was to tell you that happiness is in the nature of the object, then whether I eat it or you eat it, or you eat the 10th one or I eat the 20th one, I should still get happiness out of it, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
But that's not happening.
Right.
So where is this happiness actually? And this is where Eastern philosophy comes into it. It says that happiness, it has to be in the nature of the subject. It's not in the object or emotions and thoughts. It's the nature of the subject. So who is, what is this source of happiness? And the source of happiness is my higher self.
Right. Right?
It's my higher self. And this is what we call Sat Chit Ananda in Eastern philosophy, which is infinite bliss.
Yeah.
Which is right in me, but I'm searching everywhere for it. It's like looking for the keys of your car and they're in your pocket and you're looking all over the place for it. It's right there with you. You can choose to be happy at any point because it is your essential nature. It is your true nature.
Yeah. I think, it is. It's definitely interesting. When you describe the Western definition of what happiness means to them, which is like a clear-cut definition of what happiness is. But when you look at the Eastern philosophy, which I probably relate to a lot more, it says, okay, happiness lies within you. But we as human beings tend to look for happiness everywhere else or in somebody else because you think it is... somebody else's duty to make you happy, you feel happy because, your child said something nice to you or your spouse said something nice to you, or it's words of appreciation that you look from other people, which eventually makes you happy. Yeah, which is so true. Right. And I completely, completely relate to that.
Okay. Yeah. Let's take a short break from happiness and let me ask you, because I know you've been there and Anjali is also, she's a very close friend of ours. So, and I know she's been doing Pilates for some time now. So tell me, how does Pilates actually differ from regular workouts?
Okay. Now Pilates is a low intensity exercise regime. There are very many other low intensity exercise regimes as well, Bina. When it comes to Pilates, as an exercise regime, it's more about building awareness in one's mind and body. And that's what Pilates does. So it is a very focused, very regimental, very adaptable, and a very, very versatile practice. So, again, Pilates... as an exercise regime, when it was introduced by Joseph Pilates in the early 20th century, the practice involved rehabilitating prisoners of war. And it was more of a rehabilitative practice, which then went on to become a fitness movement practice. But again, the kind of Pilates that we practice is the classical method. So our main focus is for people to understand their bodies and accordingly be able to perform every other activity with a lot of ease and zest. Anything other than, they want to practice Pilates or, just build the whole practice into their lifestyle. Little things like the way they should be sitting, the way they should be walking, which is, what the body's intention to do movement in a functional way is what Pilates teaches you. And Pilates, again, is done on the mat as well as resistance and support-based equipment. So, which again, people do have goals, like any other fitness regime. But along the way, they get to be very aware of their body and which they can build into their lifestyle, and eventually, you know, people stay injury-free, pain-free, and which also allows them to pursue anything else they want, any other movement practice of their choice they want comfortably.
Okay. Oh, that's very interesting, because, you know, the thing is, for spiritual growth, you know, one needs to have a healthy body. And one needs to also be extremely sensitive to the body, because if you have an ailing body, then it's very difficult to actually, you know, delve into something like that, you know?
No, absolutely.
That. So that's very nice.
Absolutely. Yeah, because we deal with a lot of clients, you know, who come to us for rehabilitative purposes. And we understand that they are mentally so bogged down with their injuries and pain that they're not, again, able to be happy with their other aspects, you know, in life, because this is constantly playing at the back of their mind, that it kind of overtakes everything else that they are wanting to do in their lives, which can be quite detrimental. So the minute we see people even getting an inkling of, you know, satisfaction or being pain-free, you see that the change that they go through within themselves, you know, which is extremely gratifying for me as a Pilates instructor. So again, you know, people come to us with a lot of expectations, with a lot of goals, etc. But I always tell people, at the first place, you need to be aware of your body. You need to understand what your body can actually do, what you're capable of doing. Yes, it's great to have goals, but it's not about, you know, having, you know, baseless goals or even blind goals for yourself. So let's work through a process, and you need to kind of, you know, be smart in your body. You need to be kind to your body, you know, and that is how you can reach your goal without being bogged down by injuries or pain in the process.
Okay. So one more question I had on Pilates is that do you need to be certified fit to do Pilates? Or, I mean, if you're ailing with something, with any kind of disease, can you work around that in Pilates?
Absolutely. Because as I said, Pilates is a very adaptable and a versatile practice. So it is just not for the fit. So because it's practiced with a very, very wide range of age groups, say, you know, from the time a child can take on verbal cues, say a child of 9 or 10 years old can practice Pilates safely, and going on to active ages, who are in their 70s or 80s. So people don't need to be fit to do Pilates, because you do Pilates to get fit. Okay. Or you do Pilates to be able to stay fit. So people don't need to have any kind of preconceived requirements to do Pilates. So anybody and everybody can very safely do Pilates, because it's an injury-free practice.
All right. I can do it. I'm 66.
Absolutely. You know, Bina, my oldest client is 84, who's had, 84, who's had two hip replacements, one knee replacement, and she beautifully does Pilates, and she's actually been doing Pilates for the last 45 years.
Oh my God, that's amazing.
So it's really, you know, nice, unfortunately, you know, in India, you know, people after a point in time, after they hit their, you know, late 50s or 60s, apart from doing walking, which they think is, yes, low intensity, they do not look at any other fitness regime, maybe yoga to an extent of, you know, just getting their breathing, etc. in. But from a physical movement perspective, they think that they're not fit to do anything. You know, I mean, people need to understand, people need to look at Pilates as a movement practice that can be safely practiced across all age groups.
Oh, that's nice. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll probably come across and meet you.
No, absolutely. You should. You should come and do a lesson with us, and you'll definitely understand what I'm talking about. Now, I'm just going to pick one question that's come to us online.
Sure.
You know, Lucid Design India, you know, who's asking you, how does one bring oneself back to the present moment all the times?
All right. Okay. That's a very nice question. And the point of being, okay. So what happens is that, you know, what we tend to do is that when we're not really living in the present, because what happens is anything that we're doing, we're always sort of conditioned by our past. So we have very strong memories of things, you know, and fear comes in. You know, if you have some activity to do, sometimes you're very fearful that, you know, I did it in the past, but I didn't succeed or whatever. So now that's playing on you already. Okay.
Yeah.
Or, you know, or you're working with somebody who you dislike, for instance. I'm just giving you a few or random examples. So now that dislike is coming into play. All right. All of these are now in your brain and they're bothering you and they're, you know, they're affecting what you're actually doing in the present moment. So what you need to do is to, when you're trying to be in the present, you have to let everything in the past go. You have to take this task on like it's completely new to you. Okay.
Yeah.
And put in your best effort now. Don't worry about failure in the future as well. That's the other thing that comes into play is the future. You're worried about how it's going to pan out. So now you're worried about that. You're worried about the past. Your past conditioning is coming in. Your future fears and your, you know, insecurities are coming through. And as a result, you're not there in the present moment. So be very aware of that. So now the important thing and the important word here is to be aware of your thoughts. Right. So the only way you can be in the present is with pure awareness. Mm-hmm. You have to be aware and you have to be aware. This is playing on me or I'm worrying about that. Now let me bring my focus back onto this.
Yeah.
And it happens to us. You know, many times you're doing a task that you love doing. Okay.
Yeah.
And you completely forget about the time. You've forgotten how, whether you've eaten your food, you've forgotten about so many things. You're just there. And that is what's called being in the flow or being in the present moment. So it's quite easy to do that. Don't let fears or any kind of past, you know, influences or experiences come into play at that point in time.
Right. Thank you. Thank you for answering that question, Beena. I'm just going to pick one more question before we move on. Again, this is from Lucid Design India. Does Pilates ensure mobility of joint into joints? So are you trying to ask me if it promotes joint mobility during old age? Yes, it definitely promotes joint and musculature mobility as well, because muscles support joints. And as one tends to get old, joints again, you know, do cause issues in a human body due to wear and tear or due to, you know, degeneration of joints and bones. So Pilates definitely promotes in creating mobility. Okay, so moving on. Now, I'm sorry, I'm going to pick one more question. Skinny jeans, does physical workout bring happiness? Sabina, I'll let you take that on. Because I would say definitely yes. But, you know, let's hear it from you.
All right, it will, you know, because I'm going to talk to you about something called sattvic happiness, which is happiness when you make an effort to improve yourself. When you make a sustained effort to improve yourself, the kind of happiness you get, the kind of joy at reaching that next level is amazing. And I will be talking about that. I will talk to you about that.
Okay.
So, yes,
okay, great.
It would, you know.
Okay. So, now moving on. Now we'd like to talk to you about different types of happiness.
Okay. Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Western psychology talks about two types of happiness. There's something called hedonic well-being. And that's the happiness that you get from feeling pleasure in the moment. It relates to pleasures emanating from the five senses. So we all have these inputs. So, you know, you have your, maybe you had a meal or you heard something or whatever, you know, you get that sort of pleasure. But it actually relates much more, and an easier way to describe it, it is the wine, women and song variety. It's here today, gone tomorrow. That kind of thing.
Yeah. Okay.
So what happens is that anything that comes from external sources is very short-lived happiness.
Okay.
And hedonia actually is a Greek word, which means pleasure, joy, you know, and all of these are very short-lived in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I talked to you about bliss earlier. We started right. off with bliss. Bliss yeah. is something that just stays, you know, it's at a particular level and it's just there with you throughout.
Yeah.
So that's a different kind of happiness from what we're talking about here.
Yeah.
But then, you know, this was done by Aristippus, who was mm-hmm. a Greek philosopher, and he said mm-hmm. that, and he really enjoyed himself. He lived in the Greek palace, and he just, you know, wine, women, and song was his way of being happy. And he said, that's mm-hmm. it. Avoid anything that makes you unhappy, and just do everything that makes you happy. All right? And that's what he thought.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, it didn't work, because he turned right. out, I think he just died of unhappiness at the end.
Okay.
It was too much for him. Anyway, mm-hmm. so then after that, Aristotle came on. And I think they were actually contemporaries for a bit.
Right.
He talked about eudaimonic. And eudaimonia is happiness. And it's actually a Greek word for human flourishing or happiness and welfare. So that's right. a much more lasting sort of thing. Now here, mm-hmm. we get this happiness when we have meaning and purpose in our lives. And we right. fulfill our potential and the feeling of being a part of something bigger. All right?
Right.
So if you actually do something for somebody else, have you mm-hmm. noticed the kind of happiness you get? It's very yeah. different from doing things just purely for yourself, which is
Absolutely.
What hedonic well-being is. Yeah?
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. And the whole idea of being part of something bigger gives you meaning mm-hmm. and purpose in your life.
Right.
So, you know, it's important to do these things. But then, of course,
yeah.
this, again, is not as long-lasting because, you know, we are still looking for it outside. We're still not tapped into our own nature. Which is Sat Chit Ananda, which is
right.
eternal happiness. All right?
Right.
So now,
right.
Eastern philosophy says there are three types of happiness. We talked about two from the Western psychology perspective, but Eastern mm-hmm. philosophy you know, you may ask me why I'm comparing philosophy to psychology, but the
yeah.
Eastern philosophy and psychology is the same. There is no
right.
such thing as Eastern psychology. It always goes back into this 5,000 years of knowledge that we have, which is there
right.
in the Vedas. So
mm-hmm.
it goes back to that. And you will see
right.
that if you Google the Indian Psychology Institute or whatever, they will
mm-hmm.
still talk to you about the Vedas.
Right.
So Indian psychology and philosophy is very meshed in together.
Okay.
Right. So here we talk of three types of happiness. There's sattvic or pure happiness. And this is the happiness that comes from elevation of the soul. So if you hear
right.
some really uplifting sort of music,
mm-hmm.
or if you, you know, if you do something for somebody else, your soul gets elevated. Right.
Right.
And, you know, there's a lot of self-control and discipline required in getting sattvic happiness, which is why I talked to you about the Pilates. So, you know,
yeah.
if you regularly push at something and
yeah.
you take yourself to another level, whether it's physically
right.
or any which way, that is
yeah.
sattvic happiness.
Right? right. Yeah.
And it's much more long lasting. So we also in Eastern philosophy, we have something called rajasic or result oriented happiness. And
mm-hmm.
that, as you know, is very, very similar to the hedonic happiness that I talked to you about earlier. It's
okay.
materialistic pleasure that's derived from the senses. When the senses
right.
come into contact with external objects. Now, the one
yeah.
thing is that while we're doing this, you know what happens to us? While we're happy in this particular state, we're worrying
yeah.
about losing that happiness. There's a small little thing in our head which is saying, I hope it lasts, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So there's
yeah.
a little worry. So it actually
Correct.
Spoils your happiness for you.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
So that's rajasic happiness. And the third
right.
is tamasic or very slothful happiness. And
mm-hmm.
this is the lowest form of happiness. And it comes from just, you know, when you get tossed and turned by your instincts and your impulses into any which way without a
mm-hmm.
clear direction of what we call viveka or clear discrimination, as we
mm-hmm.
talk about in Eastern philosophy, we say it's viveka, and when
mm-hmm.
that's not developed, then you're in this state of tamasic happiness, where, you know, it's just heedless, it's
yeah.
indolent, you derive from being lazy. You derive happiness from being lazy. You derive happiness from doing, not doing things that you're supposed to be doing. So, you know, it's a very, it's the lowest form of happiness. So our Eastern philosophy divides it into these three.
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much. I mean, that was very beautifully explained, Beena. So all our viewers, you know, online, I'm sure now you know all the three types of happiness. Yeah, and you can probably, you know, categorize. So the next time you're happy, you know what kind of happiness you're going through.
And how long it will last.
And how long it lasts, right? Because one leads on to the other. Yeah, correct. Because you again, it's never ending. You just keep going on from one set to the other.
Right, yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. So now we're just going to pick another question that we have online. I'm not sure how this sits in, but I'm just going to read this out for you, Beena. How do you resolve a disruptive issue from the past?
Okay.
Is that something that you'd like to take on?
Sure, of course. Yeah.
Okay.
So, you know, it's very, very easy to do something like that. I mean, I'm saying the solution's very simple. How easy it is will depend on you. But the point of the matter is that if it's somebody that you were upset with or a situation that happened. So let's take these two possible scenarios. So if it's somebody that, you know, bothered you in the past or, you know, in some way wronged you and you're carrying the pain of that now.
Yeah.
All right. You have to understand that that person has already moved on. He's gone away and you're worrying about this. You know, you're worrying about the situation and you're carrying this grief. It's literally like carrying a sack on your head and moving through life with that burden.
Yeah, a big baggage. Know? Yeah.
Yeah, big baggage. For it doesn't make sense at all, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah.
So forgiveness. So for that particular situation, I would say just learn to forgive. Because the other thing is that if you, I mean, again, I'm going back to Eastern philosophy because there's something called karma there. So, you know, you do bad, every action has an equal and opposite reaction. Okay.
Right.
That's a scientific notion. And it carries through in our bad actions or our good actions. So the thing is that if somebody actually insulted you, maybe it was something that you did to them previously.
Right.
Which you have to sort of quietly accept in this particular, you know, lifetime. All right.
Yeah.
We are going to live many lifetimes as well. So that's one aspect. The other thing is that let's talk of situations that bothered you. All right.
Yeah.
Okay. If situations bothered you in the past, then please understand. And if I look back at my 66 years of living, I actually have realized that everything that I thought was, you know, a failure at a particular point in time, or it was disruptive for me, was actually a stepping stone to learning something.
Yeah.
Either I bettered myself in many ways. I bettered my thought process. Or I went on, a door opened and I was materially more successful. There was some door that opened at that point in time.
Yeah.
So don't look at situations in the past and just analyze them. Truly, I'm pretty sure you'll realize that it was for your benefit.
Yeah.
You're going to realize that it is for your benefit.
Yeah. No, so absolutely, which is so true. No, which is so true, because I think every experience, good or bad, you know, that each one of us go through teaches us something, you know,
absolutely.
Eventually when you look back and, you know, if people are in the habit of, you know, writing journals and notes about everything that they go through on a daily basis. And when you just look back and see as to why did I have to go through this? Because sometimes, you know, you get into this mode of constantly questioning oneself, why me? Why did this happen to me? And especially when it comes to any negative aspect. But when you look back and when you see what you have learned from that negativity or not a very pleasant experience, you realize, there you go. So this is what it taught me. And going forward, this is what, you know, my lesson learned is going to give me that amount of experience.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. No, which is so true. So I'm a little conscious about the time. We just have a little over 10 minutes, Beena. I am left with just one more question. And I'm not sure if you have any more questions to ask me with, Pilates.
I do.
I'll be happy to answer. Yeah.
Yes. So I wanted to ask you is that how many times should one do Pilates for maximum impact?
So typically, if you're starting off, if you do not actively participate in any other kind of movement regimes, I would say about twice a week is good enough. Because when you do Pilates with us, we always ensure that we give homeworks to our clients. So the days that they are not doing Pilates, they do those homeworks, at home. So they kind of build that practice into their regime. But safely twice a week. But we do have clients who come and see us at least sometimes 4 or 5 times a week as well. And that would only depend on what their goals are, what their requirements are, etc.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. So what is this homework that you talked about in Pilates?
Now, Go on.
No, so is there any equipment required or is there anything
No, not else? Really. So typically what happens is Pilates works on, fundamentals. We have 6 fundamentals that we work on. Okay. The most important fundamental is the breath factor and the concentration factor. So typically all exercises, when you work out, there is a breath mechanism that one needs to kind of practice, which initially tends to be a little hard because we as human beings don't breathe to our maximum capacity. And that's what Pilates teaches you. So we kind of give these little homework practices that whatever they're doing in the studio, we want them to be able to reiterate those movements in their bodies, with the breath factor. So that is what is homeworks. Again, depending on what the client's requirement is or what the focus is, the homeworks would differ. But when they work out at home, they don't need any equipment per se, because we give them things that they can easily do, with a mat.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, sounds good. Great. All right.
So, moving on. My last question to you today would be, what is your 3 simple lessons to a happier life?
You know, actually, Kavita, I would have loved to do this to you, do this for you, but they're beautiful parables that actually spell out the lessons. But I think because we talked so much, I don't think we have too much time to go through it.
Network. Oh, shit. Beena, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Well, I'm sorry. I think I've just had a power outage, but keep going on. I think the power will come on because my generator needs to kick in. It'll come on.
All right.
But I can hear you.
You can hear me. All right. Okay.
Yeah.
So, and I think this is very, very relevant for these COVID times. So what I would suggest is, first thing is enjoy the simple pleasures of life.
Right.
Oh, there you're back.
Yeah, I'm back.
Okay. So enjoy the simple pleasures of life. So the one thing you could do is, look at nature around you. Enjoy that hot cup of tea if somebody gives that to you. If your, daughter, your granddaughter, anybody smiles at you, just enjoy every single thing that's happening to you and around you. Because all these simple things, the simple pleasures, look at the sun, or look at nature, look at things around you and be aware. All of these things are very simple things, but they give you a lot of pleasure.
Right.
And you can do this sitting at home, if I interact with my husband just now and I give him a smile, it's going to be happiness for me and happiness for him,
Right, right.
So, it's just as simple as that. So that's what I meant by enjoy the simple pleasures of life. The second thing you should do is to declutter your space and your mind. So while you're sitting at home during these COVID times, please look at this. It's a very, very important thing to do. It's important to declutter, because what happens to us is that because of our conditioning, or our upbringing, and mine is, you know, is something that I had to be aware about, because I my mother used to hoard things, and you know, she said it'll be useful someday, it'll be useful someday, and me, and after 10 years we hadn't even used it, you know, or even I think we had forgotten about it, you know.
Yeah,
but all of these things can be so useful to somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what is important is to actually ask yourself, is it important? Is it, ask yourself three questions. Firstly, is that whatever you're hoarding, is it necessary?
Mm-hmm.
Does it energize you?
Right.
Okay. And the third thing is, have you used it in the last maybe 12 or 24 months?
Right.
And then declutter. The less clutter you have around you, you feel happier.
Yeah.
And there are lots of books and, you know, written by Japanese authors on discarding and on, you know, all of this that I spoke about just now. And, you know, it makes you feel so sort of, it seems like a burden's been lifted off you.
Right.
So declutter now, because you have the time, you can take, you know, maybe one cupboard at a time, just do one thing, then do another thing, because you're at home now, you know.
Yeah.
So you could do all of these things. So learn to do that. And then the other thing that I was going to talk to you about is try and keep your mind as clutter-free as possible. So if you can, meditate a little bit in these times.
Right.
Even if it's a two-minute meditation.
Right.
Just concentrate on your breath and just close your eyes and try to slow down your thoughts. They will still keep coming. It's not like anybody's mastered meditation and is completely thought-free. That doesn't happen. But you have to lessen the thoughts that come into your... You know, typically in a day, we get something like 50,000 to 80,000 thoughts.
Right.
And many of them, by the way, are negative, I have to say. So, so the point is that slow that process down. Don't give energy to thoughts. So a lot of these thoughts come in and they pass you by. You know, you don't give energy to them. Yeah.
Right.
So don't give energy to all these thoughts. Just let them flow by.
Yeah.
And, and just let them flow by, and you will find that it's much, much easier. You're calmer. You're in a sense, you're more content.
Okay.
So that contentment is also one definition of happiness.
Okay.
All right. So, so you can do that. The third thing that I would recommend to you is to actually make easier choices. You know, the thing is that the world just bombards us with different kinds of stimuli. All right.
Right.
And it's a constant thing. And so I know of people that will go through each and every option if they want something, like for instance, if they want, let's say you want to buy a pair of shoes, you will actually, you know, research the whole thing through, you know, you will go to several shops, you will check the shoes here, there, everywhere.
Yeah.
So have a minimum requirement. So be what they call a simplifier or satisfizer.
Yeah.
Be a satisfizer. Yeah. You get satisfied easily. So try and be that instead of trying to be a maximizer. A maximizer is a person who will study every single option.
Right.
And in that,
which is so true, Beena, which is so true, because nowadays people depend so much on other people for reviews, because, you know, people tend to shop a lot online. So they just need to look at reviews of what the other person has to say. Even though your requirement of a certain product might be very different from what reviews you're actually reading.
True. Absolutely right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So depend on yourself and just be a, what they call a satisfizer, you know, and don't be a maximizer, because maximizers do have a lot of stress, and they also, you know, they also are afraid of the one possible option that got away, you know.
Yeah.
So they're worried about that too, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
No, which is great. So, I mean, I think that's just beautiful. Yeah.
All right. So I've gone through three of these. There are many lessons on happiness, really many lessons. But I thought these were relevant for today's times. And I think let's simplify our lives, give things away, and be satisfied with much lesser.
Yeah. No, great. I think that's a really good food for thought and something for people to take away. So if you don't have any more questions for me, I think we just have like about 3 or 4 minutes before the Insta chat goes off. So,
all right.
Yeah, but it's been such a pleasure to talk to you, Beena, and I'd really like to take this opportunity to, you know, for you to come and visit our studio and see what we do and even sure. do a Pilates lesson as well.
I'd love that. Okay.
Yeah.
All
yeah.
Right. Okay.
And for all our viewers who have come online today, thank you so much for joining us. If you have joined in late, you know, this video will be recorded on IGTV. You can go back and always look at it. And if you have any questions for Beena or myself, please feel free to send them on. And if we haven't picked up all your questions today, we will definitely post them up on our story so you could look it up as well. And we look forward to bringing you all with another, you know, well-being weekend topic next week, hopefully. Until then, we'll see you and have a lovely evening. And a big thank you to Beena once again.
Thank you so much for having me here, Kavita. And thank you so much, everybody, for listening in.
Yeah, thank you. Bye now.
Bye.
Bye.